Before starting today's interview, I would like to reflect on something that I read recently. So what I read was connected with direct and indirect learning. So usme maine padha that people have two ways of learning, which goes on continuously and which is involved in both personal and professional lives. Log bahut zyada direct learning bhi karte hain, which is basically experiencing by your own. आपने कुछ देखा, आपने कुछ पढ़ा, you're making certain experiences. आप ट्रैवल कर रहे हैं, सो ऑल दोज एक्सपीरियंसेस कॉन्ट्रीब्यूट टूवर्ड्स डायरेक्ट लर्निंग. एंड एट द सेम टाइम देर इज इनडायरेक्ट लर्निंग विच इज बेसिकली लर्निंग थ्रू अदर्स एक्सपीरियंसेस. सो इफ यूर रीडिंग लेट्स से शे गुएवारा, सो लर्निंग थ्रू हिज एक्सपीरियंसेस एंड यू ट्राइंग टू इम्प्लाय और यूज दोज एक्सपीरियंसेस इन योर ओन लाइफ. टूडे आवर सेशन इज गोइंग टू बी अबाउट इनडायरेक्ट लर्निंग. तो हम आज आदित्य के साथ हैं, हु हैज scored 6th rank in RBI 2018, which is a big feat. And he's going to tell us not only about his success, but also about the failures he's faced in his life and the failures he's faced while preparing for RBI. So we are going to talk with him, understand what are the things that he did wrong, how he corrected them, and what can you learn from those mistakes so that you don't make those mistakes on your own.
Anuj, thank you for actually bringing that up, because that is something I think needs to be talked about a little more. So for example, this is my 4th attempt at RBI, and in the first 2 attempts I could not even clear prelims. In my 3rd attempt I went up till the interview stage, and I got good marks in the interview, but because I had low marks in the phase 2, I could not make it all the way through. So I think many a times what happens is, especially for students who either come from an engineering background or at the same time are coming from tier 1 or tier 2 cities, they have that thing because that I know English or I can speak English properly, so I do not need to focus on English in phase 1 or phase 2. Similarly, the same applies for the papers on quantitative aptitude, etc. And I went through the kind of the same churn. So for example, when I gave my first attempt in 2015, though it was like I was still new to it, I could not even go through the phase 1. And the reason was not actually being able to clear the entire cutoff, but it was more about actually not clearing the sectional cutoffs, which I thought would be a given. The same happened in 2016. And in my next attempt, when I went in up till the interview, so phase 1, I could like say, you know, I had that thing that, okay, these are the things which I missed up during my phase 1. So I was able to correct some of them. But again, because phase 2 was new for me, I again had some certain conceptions that this I can do, or I had that thing that I know it or I understand it, which again does not mean that I did not know it. But at the same time, what you just touched upon, that indirect learning, or like, you know, learning from others, not just mistakes, but taking help or mentorship or guidance from others.
Right.
So that is something which I missed out on in my 3rd attempt. And in my 4th attempt, like say, thanks to you and like say, you know, other people who have been preparing with me, I was able to understand that what does it take to kind of not repeat the same mistakes.
Right.
Having said that, it does not mean that others will be able to, like say, you know, give you a good tea which you can just drink up and like say, you know, learn everything or clear the examination. But what is very important, or an important component, is I think the guidance or mentorship, which can come from different sources. It can be people who have cleared the examination, it can be people who are in a similar environment, and in this case, like say, you know, like I have, say, many people would not know it, but I have been in constant touch whenever, like, that say, you know, 1 week before the exam, 2 weeks before the exam, ki kuch nahi pada, and you were like, theek hai, you know this, just do these things.
Right.
So I think that has really helped, and that is something I would kind of reiterate is very, very important, and is a good theme to have for today's discussion. That how you can actually, or how you should use these resources around you, and they come in different forms and shapes, to actually, like say, you know, reach to your goal, both as you said, personally and professionally. Today we are talking about RBI Grade B, but I think that is a very, very important thing which all youngsters, like say, and people also end up going into both extremes. So some people think that they know it all, and some people think that somebody else is going to give them what they need.
Right. You have to combine both.
So you have to combine both of them and find the middle path.
Right.
So I think that is very, very important. And thanks for actually making that the introductory theme for the discussion. Like, I really, really think that that is something, a message needs to go out in terms of, like, say, having that approach for people.
Right, right. In fact, you know, students like Ali, like Abhishek, and you, who have stayed in touch with me for a very long time, all of you have sent out this message, and through me, they're like trying to connect with the students and telling me regularly that we would like to you know, mentor the students, tell them what to do, what not to do. So I think it's a very good platform to, you know, send out this message and tell the students that if they have any doubts, any confusions, even after this session, this interview, they can directly or indirectly get in touch with you, all of you guys. You guys have done wonderfully in the examination. So you guys can certainly give them certain tips and tricks which they can use and not make the same mistakes which probably you made when you were preparing. So let me just give a brief introduction about you, because students must be wondering what exactly have you done in your educational and professional life. So as I said, rank 6 in RBI 2018. He passed out, he did his engineering and passed out in the year 2012. Then he went on to work in the US for a year. Sounds very fancy, but then he came back and worked in Bangalore for a year and a half. So that shows that coming back from the US was not just about, you know, getting into the government sector. It was also a move that he made just because probably he wanted to come back to the country and work here. So, wo ek bahut achhi cheez hai, and I think it shows us that people who go out and work in the US or somewhere else are like normal people, and they fourth attempt, that means he was not probably that good when he started with the preparation. So, kuch alag nahi hai aap logo se, whoever is preparing for the exam. Then he kept working and simultaneously started his preparation for UPSC, and he's currently also working. While you were preparing for RBI, you were working at the same time. So I think that's a wonderful feat. Prepared and cleared the exam, worked on and off, took some leaves, and you know, kept working. So he's working presently as business development and strategist in a social sector enterprise. And as he said, this was his fourth attempt in RBI. And he gave his interview in third attempt. So in both first and second attempt, he was not able to clear the prelims as well. So that shows that people from engineering backgrounds can also make those mistakes. And that teaches us a lot, that what are the mistakes that he made. Probably we'll go and discuss about them. And how can you stay away or avoid those kinds of mistakes. So let's go back and talk a little about your corporate job. So when was it that you decided कि नहीं अभी corporate job नहीं करनी है, या फिर you want to come back to India and work and simultaneously probably prepare and look for other opportunities?
So the journey has been a bit long for me in that sense that 2012 to now, so a lot of things have changed over this period of time, but at the same time one thing has been constant, that again it might sound as a cliche thing, but while I was there in the US, so there are so many good things, and like both personally and professionally, which you really enjoy and relish every moment. But at the same time, I was always thinking that why don't we have all those things here in India? Why can't that set up again? It has to be contextualized to the Indian setting. But like, say, you know, why can't we have the same ease of doing things? So for example, now it's very easy for you to use Paytm and pay your electricity bill online. So that was not the case in 2011, 12, 13.
Right.
It was hardly, I think, some few states and few cities like Bangalore where you could do. So like those things really hit me hard. Like where I was thinking that, say, you know, oh, like say, why can't this happen? And coincidentally, again, might sound irrelevant to some people. That was the time when Aamir Khan also came up with his show Satyamev Jayate. So I remember, like, say, you know, sitting in front of the screen every Sunday and, like, say, you know, trying to watch that show. And I think that is where the inspiration started from, that I want to come back and do something in India. It does not have to be, like, say, direct public service. It does not have to, but it's about, like, say, coming back and doing whatever you can in your own sphere, in your own way. Even an engineer, a scientist who is working, he's no different from any other public servant in whatever capacity. So that thing was there, that whatever learnings I can take from here, I have to imbibe that, and I want to go back to my country and work in a more familiar setting where I can contribute more. And I think another thing which is very important to realize is that India is the hub or the center of activity. You cannot say India is the center of everything, but for all practical purposes, India is where all the opportunities exist. So even now, or even then, people who are there are either looking to invest in India or move back to India to actually make use of the opportunities that exist. So I think we are very blessed to be in an age, especially say, you know, people in our age group, where there are challenges, but the kind of opportunities that exist and the impact you can make. Again, not just limited to one thing, but if you are trying to, like, let's say, run a business, so the impact or the width to which you can expand that business. If you're trying to be a researcher, the amount you can collaborate within India. So I think this is a very good or a lucky time to be in India. So I think that was another reason why I decided to kind of move back. And specifically coming to RBI per se, so I was very, very averse to the idea of working for any government organization. Let me be very clear about that. So like for me, it was very, very difficult to think of going into a sarkari setup where things are very slow, don't move properly. But then through some of my friends, I came to know about RBI and how it functions. The ecosystem which it gives you, because it's an organization of technocrats. So the people you work with, the kind of opportunities it gives you. So for example, many people would have heard of the Golden Jubilee Scholarship, which RBI gives, using which you can go for higher studies. Similarly, the amount, it also kind of focuses on a work-life balance. And at the same time, giving its employees all the opportunities to learn, keep learning, and contribute. So say, for example, we would have heard of these committees which the RBI appoints. So even when you join in, you cannot become a member, but if you show interest over the years, you can start getting associated with such committees. So, and think of it in this way, that it is the central bank of one of the biggest or the emerging economies of the world. So that is very enticing to me. And the main thing, that the way RBI is as an organization and the way it treats its employees is very, very different. So you might as well say that RBI is a government organization with all the positives of what people would look for in a corporate job. So I think that is very enticing for me, and that is how I decided that, like, say, you know, I would appear for the RBI Grade B exam.
You know, I think that's very impressive, because majority, and I say that this with no doubt, majority of the people who are looking for a job or who are looking to join any government organization, let it be UPSC, let it be any other organization, one of the main concerns is, or one of the main ideas behind, you know, joining such an organization is that we'll get a government job. And on the other hand, I've been repeatedly saying this, that you know, you have to go in with an aim of learning more, with an aim of joining an organization which fits with your future objectives. And that, I think, that you've you know, caught very nicely, that you did not want to join in a government organization when you came back or while you were working in the US, because it did not sink in with your objectives, with your ambitions. But when you learned more about them, you realized that, okay, RBI. So you're looking at RBI from a different perspective, not from the perspective that, okay, 10 to 5. From the perspective that you'll get to work with these technocrats who are the policy makers of the nation when it comes to economics of India. So that's, you know, a flip, another dimension of RBI, which we normally miss out on, which is all the more important, or even more important than the other dimension, which is it being a government job. So it's very impressive that you're thinking like that. And I think all of us, while learning or preparing, should also be thinking like that, so that learning is fun that way and it's not a burden anymore.
Yeah. Coincidentally, I was asked a similar question in the interview as well, where, like, I think the chairman of the board this time, so he was very, like, how I would say, very polished, and at the same time, he knew what he had to ask. So he threw me a difficult question where he said, why are you even here? Are you even serious about joining RBI?
Hmm.
And like, you know, I could have gone about like, you know, giving a round and round answer or given the same answer in a non-personal way.
Hmm.
But I gave a similar answer to him that why. And I think it really synced with him because
yeah.
I heard from experiences of many students that like, you know, the chairman specifically, like say if he did not like your answer, he would show it on his
face. Show it on his face, yes.
So like, you know, that is one thing which I think, again, maybe we can talk a little more about the interview at a later stage.
Hmm.
But I think that is one thing, one key takeaway that you will face those what you would categorize as HR related questions. Why RBI?
Yes.
Why after engineering here?
Right.
Failed UPSC, etc., etc. So I think it's very important to, yes, you have to kind of have a well-thought answer, but at the same time, it's very important, at least in such questions, to say what you really believe, because
right.
I think those people are very experienced to see through your lies.
Right.
Yeah. So.
Right. And it happens very often. Every year, whenever I take mock interviews, that's the first question that everybody asks. Sir, we are not able to identify what to say to the question of why do you want to join RBI, because it's, to them, it's like government job, you know, obvious move after your studies or after you've worked in the private sector. But if they ask themselves and if they, you know, make that introspection, then that answer will automatically come out.
Yes.
So I think it's good. Yeah, you have to give some personal touch to the answer so that the board starts believing in what you have to say.
Yes.
Right. So coming back to, you know, your work ex and after you came back, so you must have faced a lot of challenges in moving back to studies. And at the same time, because you were also working at the same time for a long time, so syncing studies and work at the same time, because a lot of students face the same problem and you were working on top of that in the private sector. So how did you, you know, cope up with that challenge?
I think that's a very important question to answer. So frankly, for the first few months, almost a year, I could not.
Hmm.
Like, it becomes difficult, and I think more than time management,
hmm.
it's about the psychological demons which you have to kind of overcome, that
right.
I have to do this as well as this.
Hmm.
But at the same time, I think what plays a major role there is that you know what you are doing and you have a plan or a strategy for it. So, for example, what I have seen with many exams, the mistake which even I have done is that people think I'm starting today, end of 1 year, I'm an officer.
Mm.
Or I'm starting today, end of 1 month, I'm going to write a mock and I'm going to get the highest marks possible.
Mm.
So I think especially, and I wouldn't call them as constraints, but even if you're working simultaneously, so what you need to do is you need to kind of pace your studies, and at the same time, that does not mean you are compromising on it, on how much you do.
Hmm.
But at the same time, you are not getting into a cycle where you think that today I was going to do this, but I haven't done this, and at the end of 1 month, you're still thinking about the same thing which you were thinking about on day one of the month.
Hmm.
So what is very important is you have a clear plan where you know or understand that this is what I am going to do, like let's say at the end of the day, or I'm going to spend the weekend doing this.
Mm.
And then you ensure that you cover that much.
Mm.
And if that is followed properly, I think after a month, month and a half, when you actually have a base,
mm.
because it's all about the base, like say, unless and until you know or realize that this is what I know well and this is what I don't know well, your preparation hasn't really started.
Mm.
But forming that base is very important.
Mm.
And I feel that if you have a clear strategy, and again, like just to reiterate the point, don't be so ambitious again that I'm going to finish this within this month.
Mm.
If you are able to actually finish 50% of something which you set out for month one,
mm.
you would see that your efficiency, your motivation to do the remaining things in month two, month three, which people at times think will get too much to do,
hmm.
because of the success you have had in month one in accomplishing or setting that base,
hmm.
it becomes relatively easier. So
hmm.
I think that is one thing I would kind of suggest to people who are trying to do it while they're working.
Hmm.
Have a clear strategy, and then stick to it.
Follow up at the same time.
Yes, yes.
So basically walking like a tortoise rather than trying to be a rabbit and running around here and there.
Because everybody knows, right? Like, say, though that does not mean people haven't studied, but you would see people frantically, like, you know, turning pages one day, 1 week before the exam. So that does not mean they did not have, say, you know, all the time before. They have been at least thinking that they were studying for the past 4 months, 6 months, whatever. So you might as well use that time. Jaise wo hota na ki boon boon se ghada bharta hai. So I think it's
the same, especially for people who are working.
Yeah, yeah.
Because unke paas time nahi hai already. They're always short of time. So thoda thoda dalenge to it'll accumulate over time.
And I think, like, coming back to how I started this answer with, like, so it's all psychological. And it is very important to know that you are proceeding in the right direction, and, like, you know, doing one bit at a time will really give you that confidence and boost that then again, within that 1 hour itself, you will be able to grasp more content, you will be able to do more and be more productive.
Right.
And like another thing which I would probably like to point out or highlight is, I think working is also a very good way of actually clearing these exams, and I would kind of explain why. So I think when you start working, you come out from a shell which was just as a student. So the way you think, the way you act, the way you respond, all of that goes a sea change when you start working. So this is one advice which I give to many of my juniors, that if they are coming out of college, so I tell them that whatever it is, just work for 6 months. After that, if you want to start preparing for an exam, do that. So it might not apply for everyone, but I do think that working helps polish your personality in many ways, broadens your horizon. And I think that, at least I feel, really helps in the examination process or going through that examination process in a different way. So right. I also think that helps, like working in general helps. So
that's a really nice advice. Yeah. So, because you're an engineering student, this question is specifically meant for all the engineers out there. There are a lot of them who are preparing for the exam. So, because you're from that background, you must have had some preconceived notions about phase one specifically, quantitative aptitude, reasoning, English, and so on. So, what are the mistakes that you made while preparing for phase one? And why and how and when did you realize ki nahin, ye galat ho raha hai abhi, I need to change my strategy. I'm an engineering student does not mean that I can get through with phase one just like this. So what happened out there?
So I think as you said that, say, you know, being an engineering student, you have preconceived notions ki ye to aata hai. So what would happen is that while preparing for the phase one, many a times I wouldn't even care to, like, look at problems of time and work, time and speed, because I would think ki ye to ho jata hai. And it's not like I couldn't do it, but the accuracy and the time in which you have to do these problems in the exam environment. So if you do not realize that so people from other backgrounds, and I'm not talking about engineering, non-engineering, but people in general will get ahead of the curve. And that is all that matters. So many people would say that phase one mein aadhe number se reh gaya, ek number se reh gaya. Like, I also have done the same, where I could clear the entire cutoff, but not the sectional cutoff. So I think in that case, that is something where engineering, non-engineering does not matter at all. And what you also have to realize is that in the phase one of RBI, 80 marks are for general awareness, 60 marks are for logical reasoning. So while you can say that logical reasoning is where engineering students may have an advantage, let's say that. But I don't think that's the case, because logical reasoning, it's more about how you can grasp that problem. So 80, 60, 140, 30 marks English. So 170 marks out of 200 are actually something which everyone should ideally be able to do with ease, as long as they have put that time in it. So I think that engineering versus non-engineering comparison is not fair, because at the same time, considering how difficult quantitative aptitude is, and people get, if the cutoff is 7.5, people get 10, 11, 12 marks. So I don't think anybody is gaining any big advantage there. And at the same time, what I would say is to all the people who are from a non-engineering background, do remember that 170 marks are completely in your grasp. And whatever you have to do in quantitative aptitude is again doable. And trust me, everyone is struggling with it in some way or the other, because the level of quantitative aptitude, what they're asking is something which you just can't do. You have to practice. So even an engineering student is practicing before going into the paper. If he's not, he's clearly going to miss out on the cutoff for sure. I have been there. So I can, like, you know, at least talk about my own self.
Connected with this is the question that you just said, that you have to find the right set of questions, because QA is very tough. You cannot solve all those 30 questions. 15 are non-doable, 15, only 15 out of those 30-50% are doable. So what was the strategy, or how did you, you know, work upon finding out the right set of questions, especially in QA and reasoning, that you had to do? So what is that one way in which you can develop that skill?
So I think one thing which you have to realize is many a times people would ask that which section to focus on. So one thing which I would like to kind of highlight or stress is that no matter how big a section is in terms of its marks or how easy it seems, you have to balance it out. So for example, quantitative aptitude, the way it is today, it wasn't that difficult earlier. And at the same time, you do not know how it is going to be in 2019 or 2020. The same applies for English, the same applies for logical reasoning. So number one, you have to give equal focus to all sections, not just because there are sectional cutoffs, but also because I don't think you can predict how it is going to go. What if one time the quantitative aptitude section becomes too easy, but because you were just aiming for those 12-13 marks, everyone else is scoring 25 plus or 20 plus, and you are still around 16-17 because you did not give enough focus on quantitative aptitude as a section. So I think that is one part which I would like to highlight, that equal focus needs to go into each section. And then the second part on how to attempt the paper. So what I would say is, know your areas of strength. So to kind of give an example, if I'm going into logical reasoning, though I know that there are set questions which are seating arrangement, vertical floors, etc. But the moment, for example, I see a circular seating arrangement in which people are sitting facing the center as well as outside, I know it's a no-go for me. Not because I cannot solve it, but it's because I know that the amount of time it is going to take is not going to be worth it. While at the same time, because the level of complexity of the question is a little higher, there's also a probability that you might not solve it right. So for things like that, and again, like, it's not about this one particular example. So someone might be very, very comfortable doing this. So it's all about identifying what you can do and what you face a little difficulty in doing. And again, having said that, that does not mean you don't need to solve these kind of questions. So I'm prepared for it. But at the same time, I'm kind of thinking on the fly there. So for example, if on the day of the examination, I know I'm not able to solve other papers or number series questions are very difficult. So then I have to come back and solve this question. And this decision needs to be taken in a split second. Like, you do not have 5 minutes or 1 minute to think about it. So you have to be very well prepared. But at the same time, know what to skip and what not to. Especially in logical reasoning, why I'm using this example is because there are 60 questions. And no matter how well prepared you are, I think everyone would struggle to go through those 60 questions. So if you can actually skip, like, let's say one set of 5 questions and maybe another 2-3, you will at least reach or go through the 60 questions once, where again, it's not about attempting all of those, but where you can see that there are questions which are very easy. Questions on syllogism, questions on, for example,
there's verbal reasoning there.
Verbal reasoning. Yeah. So I think those questions are easier to attempt. Again, might vary from person to person. But it's important to know what not to do, especially in phase one. It's very, very important. Otherwise, the difference would be doing, like, let's say, 28 questions in a section versus doing 36. And that, I think, creates a huge difference.
So it's basically preparing yourself for the entire paper, and at the same time preparing yourself to leave questions in the final exam, where you feel that you cannot attempt it, or you cannot attempt it in the required time.
Yes,
right. Probably a question attached to that is, So we're talking about knowledge, we're talking about how much hard work we have to put. So what's more important? Because a lot of times students call me and tell me, sir, bahut zyada pad liya, but even then we are not able to clear. A lot of students are there who have been studying very hard for the past 3-4 years, working also at the same time, putting in their day in and day out, and not able to get through. So how do they ensure that along with knowledge, along with this accumulated knowledge and hard work, they're also able to smartly put in that knowledge, that hard work in the practical life situation of that examination hall and clear the paper? Because we see a lot of students struggling out there.
So I think this leads us back to a couple of things which we were discussing earlier. So this is a mix of, so the answer to this is a mix of options in terms of, so I think one is definitely there are people who are working or studying really hard. So the problem that probably they are facing is, number one is they do not have the right mentorship. And again, that mentorship does not have to come from a coaching institute or anyone. It's just about either some people have it on their own, that say, because they have been through the same process again and again, so they know that what is it that they did wrong, and that is how we even started this session. So I think how such people can move further is to actually find people or find it within themselves to understand that what is the change in approach that is needed. And that is where the whole concept of mentorship, guidance, talking to other people, I think that is comes in. And at the same time, I also think it's about having a plan. So many a times we dive into something head first and do not realize that. So you have to make a universe for yourself that this is what I'm doing. But at the same time, you also need to be ready to test out that, is this universe still relevant? If for, like, let's say next year's FM paper in phase two, if I'm still doing just numericals, while this year numericals were not asked, there was hardly one numerical. So do I have to adapt to it? But at the same time, if I'm like, nahi, jo maine 2017 mein padha tha, I will just do numericals, numericals, numericals. You have to focus on it, but at the same time, your universe has changed. So I think that is also very important in this preparation, that you need to keep reassessing yourself. And I think one very good way of doing that is attempting previous year's papers and at the same time giving mocks. Because mocks really help you identify that what is it that you are missing. And again, it might not be something that big which is going to have a big kind of impact on your exam score, but it at least forces you to think that this is what probably I missed out, or this is a dimension I haven't covered yet. So I think mocks both have an educative purpose, and at the same time, they also, in addition to having that educative purpose, they also promote that thinking in you where you reassess that, maybe do I need to do this? Do I not need to do this? Or maybe you realize that though I am, for example, I have studied, let's say, if you're talking about, again, logical reasoning. So if you're talking about, like, let's say questions on seating arrangement, let's use the same example. So mocks will help you understand that, oh, by the way, that though I'm able to solve that question, but earlier I did not realize that I'm taking 10 minutes to solve that question, and boss, that's not going to work in the actual examination. So I think mocks really help. And again, at the same time, if you have someone as your sounding board, so he or she will also be able to tell you that that this is what you are doing wrong, and not about just doing wrong. It's also about saying, many times, as you were saying, ki people call you up and are like, ki, ye nahi ho raha hai, ya itna karne ke baad bhi nahi ho raha hai. So just having someone who you know is there to kind of, you know, just guide you through that journey. So that is what my advice
would be. So both psychological and at the same time a lot of introspection required.
Yes.
To move in a smart direction. So we have not talked about in detail, students must be thinking about that, we've not talked about in detail when it comes to strategy per se for phase 1 and phase 2. And he shall be talking about it in another video, wherein he will be focusing completely on the preparation strategy that he followed for both phase 1 and phase 2. But for now, let's move to the rapid fire and end up the session. So some personal questions out there. Who would you idolize, or who do you idolize the most?
Okay. So for me, it's not a person as such, but for me, it's the institution of the teacher.
Hmm.
And teacher both in the traditional sense of teachers in school, college, otherwise. Hmm. And also, again, so this is a thing that will, I think, when I will see this video, I'll realize how many times I've used the word mentor or guide.
Hmm.
But, like, say, you know, people who, like, say, you know, help you achieve higher things in life. So I have been, like, say, you know, and I say it with a lot of pride that, say, you know, I've had brilliant teachers throughout my school life, college life, and even afterwards, like, say, you know, I've had very good mentors. Mm-hmm. Even, like, say, when I was working, I've had very good mentors, and they are the equivalent of teachers to
right.
me.
Right.
And, like, say, you know, again, not to just kind of make it because we are having this session, but, like, say, you know, in many ways,
mm-hmm.
so, say, you know, you have been a good mentor to me, like, say, you know, whenever it came about this examination in terms of stuff which we needed to study,
mm-hmm.
and at the same times where I would get frustrated that, say, you know, ye kyun padhna hai, like, you know, why do I need to study this? Because that used to happen a lot with me, ki ye kya
right.
bakwas hai.
Right.
Like, you know, why do I need to study this? Why is it even important?
Right.
Where, say, you know, so I think that is teachers in general is who I really idolize.
Hmm.
And at the same time, like, say, you know, whenever I get a chance, like, say, in informal settings, and I really hope that some point in my life I can, like, say, you know, in a formal setting,
hmm.
also, say, you know, give back to a lot of people the way, like, you know, my teachers throughout my life have given to me. So again, a very
That's
long
amazing.
Answer,
yeah.
but teachers.
okay, in one word now, one thing that students should do while preparing and should not do while preparing.
So I think one thing which students should do, the single word answer should be for that is consistency.
Hmm.
And one thing which they should not do is procrastination, because I think that kills them and you wouldn't even realize it, but you would be moving from one attempt to the next attempt.
Right. And a lot of working people actually do that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Especially that particular lot. What are you looking for to the most in the first few months in RBI?
So there are a couple of things. One of them is at a personal level.
Mm.
So at the personal level, like, I've been interacting with a few other people who have gotten through.
Mm.
And, like, it has been some time where I was in that college setting. So I'm hoping that the training session, the training period where we all go in as a group or a bunch.
Right.
So I'm really looking forward for that collective experience where you will get to interact with a lot of other bright people and who have different interests.
Hmm.
So that is one thing which I'm really looking forward to.
Hmm.
And professionally, so from what I know, like, say, when during your training sessions, you get to interact with a lot of the senior management in RBI who come and say, you know,
right.
give talks about what to expect, how to approach things. So I'm also really looking forward to that in terms of where they share their knowledge and expertise.
Hmm.
And also, like, say, you know, where they would probably give us advice on how to kind of, say, you know, progress career wise in RBI, what to do, what not to do, just the way I am probably, say, you know, talking about this examination. So I'm really
right,
looking forward
right.
to both.
I think that's a very nice thing to say, because once you enter such a big organization, especially it being a government organization, you tend to have a laid back attitude in life, and that happens with a lot of
yeah,
us.
Yeah,
it's
sure.
very human. But at the same time, reminding yourself that what we started with, learning is a continuous process. So if you keep reminding yourself, okay, these are the opportunities that I'm going to get, but they're going to last only for the next 2-3 months. So isko main use kar lunga, to baad mein fayda hoga. So I think that's a very good way of looking at life. Okay, next question. One thing of India that you missed in the US, and one experience of or thing of US that you miss here.
So for that, for me, these answers are very clear in terms of, so one thing which I missed while I was in the US is the desiness. Because, like, again, so my story is not ki main ek chote gaon se aaya hoon, whatever, but I have grown up in a rural setting. Or, you know, that is the way the upbringing has been. So like, say, though stupid, but calling someone oye or, say, you know, having street food or just, say, you know, the informal nature of relationships And the abundance of such relationships and those genuine relationships is something which I missed in the US. For example, I never knew who my next door neighbor was for the longest of the times when I stayed there. So that is like the desiness is something I definitely missed. And one thing about US which I miss here is the professionalism and how much people value each other's time. So that is something which I definitely miss here. Like say, you know, the respect people give to each other and the way they respect each other's time is something which I do think can be improved.
Can be improved
in India. India, yeah.
That's very true. Okay, one thing that you would go back to as soon as you find time, because you must have been very busy past, you know, 7-8 months.
I just love to sleep. So that is my answer for everything, that I love to catch up on my sleep. so that way I'm a simple man. Whenever I get a chance, I would like just sleep, have a good meal, and just sleep. So, yeah. And like, because I've been working for some time now, so that is something I've been missing on. Or say, you know, that just sleeping without caring is something I've missed for some time. So whenever I get a chance.
Your eyes are closing even now.
Yeah, no.
One quote that keeps you up and running.
Okay. So though there might be many, but so this is something which I think is relevant in this context is I hear, I forget, I see, I remember, I do, I understand. So I think this is a very simple, and many of us would have come across it throughout our lives in different versions, but the need or what you learn by practicing is, I think, something which is irreplaceable. So for people who would watch a video, like let's say, or say, you know, who would just see that, okay, this is how he's solving a sum or this is how he's explaining the concept, but actually not go back and invest time in that. And that applies for different things throughout our life. So this is something specific to the exam. But I think that is something which you need to ingrain, that unless you put in the hard work or the sweat, like, you know, doing something on your own, like, you know, no matter what you learn otherwise, or if you think I'm just going to read something, I'm just going to listen to a video. So I think that is very important and is the perfect quote in this scenario.
Basically, active learning is the best method of learning. So this brings us to the end of the session. I have a very small gift for Aditya, which I've already sent to all the students. I hope you like it. It's a very personal gift which has been sent to all the selected ones out there. I hope you like this particular video, wherein we discussed, and the theme of the session was focused upon learning through personal and professional experiences, and also the importance of direct and indirect learning. For more such videos, you know, stay tuned to our channel, and if you want to connect with Aditya, you can mention in the comment section, and through me you can connect with him directly. And he can probably find time and mentor you guys for the upcoming examination. All the very best. Take care.